11 degrees in L.A. at the moment.
Oh. Nice. Well, Christopher Redman is here, Ottawa film critic and filmmaker from Dear Cast and Crew. How are you, sir?
Good, good. Good morning. I made it. Okay. I stayed to the end last night.
Have you slept at all?
I did. I slept a bit, yeah. Okay, but let me tell you, if you're one of these people who watched this, you know, the first 2 hours and 45 minutes of this 3 hour and 45 minute show and fell asleep, you are forgiven, okay? It was a bit of a snoozer for a long time, you know? And, I mean, right from that opening number that Neil Patrick Harris, I was really looking forward to this. If you saw when he did the Tonys in 2012, go look it up on YouTube. It's amazing. People are standing up. Their jaws are dropped in the middle of his performance.
Right.
This one, he's just going through the motions. I felt like he never really got started. And then it was just bad pun after bad pun, and I was just cringing a lot of it, you know, and in a weird way, again, the best part of the Oscars was the speeches. It's weird, but you get these people going up there, you know, winning for best foreign language film, and it's kind of the best part. It's awkward, it's nervous. I'm sitting there with people who are cringing, but the cringing is kind of part of what makes it interesting.
Well, they talk too long and they go off on these weird rants, but sometimes, the music starts and they run out of music.
Yeah, exactly. They kind of stop, like, oh, the music's not kicking them off. We're just going to stop and give up. And, you know, part of that is actually kind of fun, but overall, I mean, it was kind of a rough night overall, but I mean, award wise was interesting. Every film, it was the first time since they've expanded the categories expanded the number of nominees for Best Picture. Right. Every film actually won some award. So Selma got the music award, right? American Sniper got a sound mixing, Imitation Game got a writing award. Everything got something, but of course the big winner was Birdman, which was a bit of a surprise for a lot of people. It didn't feel like it was going to be that movie that was going to take it initially, but if you follow the awards beforehand, it was coming. And the other thing is, okay, the Oscars love movies about actors and show business, right? So Birdman, of course, it wins. It's like Argo, right? Argo is all about how Hollywood helped save these, you know, hostages in Iran.
Right.
Or The Artist a couple years before that, right? Which is all about this love letter to cinema.
Yeah.
Or it's the reason why Shakespeare in Love beat, you know, Saving Private Ryan, because it's about actors.
Yeah.
So that's always a red herring if you ever want to figure out your Oscar pool.
Really?
Should it have been the big winner?
You know, I mean, I probably would have liked Boyhood to win, like a lot of people. I think it was a bigger cinematic achievement.
Right.
I was also kind of rooting for The Imitation Game. I thought that one was a really good. It almost checked too many boxes. And the Oscars, you know, it's predictable in a lot of ways, but that one, in any other year, I think would have walked away with it.
Right.
But so it was a little different, you know, to see Birdman win.
So we've been teasing the fact that you have a list of ways to improve the Oscars.
Yeah, yeah. So let's just not complain. Let's talk about what we can do to make these better, right?
Positive.
Okay, let's
solutions,
think positive. So we got five suggestions here. Number one, you know, it was even the first joke that he made, the Oscars so white. You know, that was a big thing this year. They need to rejuvenate this membership a little bit, right? It's very old and it's very white.
Okay.
Well, we know why it's old. It's because first of all, it takes a while to get in, to get enough accomplishment. But then once you're in for life. So it's kind of like this death watch waiting for people to die so you can get in. Yeah, it's you're there for life.
You don't pay a membership fee every year? And if you
You do. Well, there's ways you can get kicked out, but otherwise you're in for life. And a lot of these guys, they're not even watching the films, right? And so what they need to do is I can't believe I'm saying this. They need to take a page from the Canadian Senate. Okay, they need term limits. All right, so you're only on for maybe 8 years.
Right.
Rejuvenate that membership, keep it young, make it a little more interesting. Right, so that's one thing you can do.
Okay.
Another thing another suggestion: the foreign language film category. Right, these films come up, everyone their eyes gloss over. They go, "Oh, I've never heard of that film. Never heard of that film."
Right,
that should be a major award. This is the best film in the world that's not in the English language.
Yeah.
You turn that into a World Cup style tournament. So imagine every film, right, from around the world. There's about 80 that get submitted. They all go into pools. Right, so then we'd actually follow. We'd say, "Oh, Canada's film is playing against the Argentina film and the film from Nigeria and China," and you advance different pools. People would be following this for months, and it would keep you interested. So when you saw that a movie like Ida won, which is this black and white Polish film, you'd be like, "Well, of course Ida won. I mean, it beat France, it beat all the heavy hitters." You know, we could follow it a bit more. Right now, these films feel like they come out of nowhere. They don't get distributed usually till after the Oscars. So that would be one way to really improve it.
Cool.
Another one. Here's a suggestion. Okay. Best stunts. This is a category they need. It's one of the last kind of major professions in the film industry that have an award.
That's true.
And they actually voted it down in 2011. People put it forward. But it's because people don't understand how stunts are still done. You think, oh, it's digital and stuff. So what you need to do is like the Olympics, okay? Sometimes you need to have a demonstration of the sport.
Yeah.
Right? So next Olympics, let's get these Evel Knievels on stage. Let's get them doing their thing. I mean, these guys are always behind some of the biggest budget movies in Hollywood, right?
Yeah, right.
They're risking their lives for this, I think they deserve an award. All right, so let's get that in there.
All right.
Okay, now my second last one. No, this one's a little more complicated. They're not complicated, but another way to see who's going to win the actor award, it's always really obvious. If you're playing someone based on real life, you always end up winning.
Yeah.
Right? So for the men, you know, you're playing Stephen Hawking. We know that it's kind of an impression, and we really reward that, it seems. You know, in fact, I can't remember the number right now, but it's about like 10 of the last 13 actors have been portraying someone who was a real life person. Gotcha. Same with the women. So what you have to do, you actually should divide the categories of actors into portrayals of fictional characters made up from scratch and biographical characters.
Yeah,
right?
Like
this is what they do in writing, right? For the writers, it's adapted screenplay if it's based on something, right. an original screenplay if it's new. So this way, at least we wouldn't know that, oh, who's playing someone with, you know, that we know and recognize? Is it Ray Charles?
Idea.
Oh, they're going to win. Yeah. Right?
Ray
Charles. Yeah. It's just always a dead giveaway. The last one. This is a big one. If they did this, I guarantee their numbers would skyrocket next year at the Oscars.
Okay.
You eliminate the distinction between male and female actors.
Yeah.
Get rid of that. Only one award for best actor, whether you're male or female. It's not a different job you're doing.
Right.
Right?
Right.
You don't have best female director.
I'm with you on that one. It seems really weird.
You know, think about it. It's like these men and women, it's not like, sometimes they even are competing for the same roles, believe it or not. You look at Angelina Jolie, you look at Tilda Swinton, Angela Bassett. They've all, in the last couple of years, taken roles from men that were supposed to be, you know, parts for men. But also, if you're going to divide by sex, you might as well divide by race, because it's not like any black actors were up for the same role that the white actors were. So it's not like only men compete for men roles, right? It's acting is acting. We should be comparing characters to characters. And this way we would actually have this conversation about the roles that women have, and we could actually see, oh, you know what? Yeah, Julianne Moore's role, maybe it wasn't nearly as rich as Eddie Redmayne's role, but we would actually talk about it in those same terms as opposed to thinking, oh, they're a different category of women. It's not like a sport where you have some biological advantage, maybe, right? Men are over women.
Yeah.
So I think it would be really revolutionary, but it shouldn't be. You know, it'd be just, we'd all, maybe you could have this transition thing where you'd have three women and three men are nominated, you know, just to even it out, but only one winner.
Right.
I love that.
Think about it. Think about it.
I am a lot. Those are really great ideas.
Yeah, it's a great take on that. It's Ottawa filmmaker Christopher Redman. You'll find a link for him at live885.com and then click on Startup. Thanks a lot, Chris.
Thank you.
It's the